Welcome to the Mental Insights Podcast, a conversation aimed at understanding all sides of mental health, addiction recovery, and homelessness. Each interview will include one's personal experiences and insights or an expert's advice and knowledge within one of these fields. The goal is to promote awareness, guidance, and support for anyone who is affected by these challenges. Thank you all for listening. Welcome to the Mental Insights Podcast. This is your host, Brennan Catulli. We are here today for episode number 11 of season 2 of the Mental Insights Podcast. This episode is with Joshua Perry. Joshua is a former professional athlete who suffered a crash that left a brain tumor in the left half of his brain. It took only 5 weeks after surgery for Josh to get back on his bike. Two more brain tumor diagnoses have happened since 2010, and now Josh is focused on the power of health and nutrition. Josh will join the Mental Insights podcast to speak about the ketogenic diet and consciousness, as well as his experience of development throughout his life. Josh, thanks for taking this time out to be with me today and share not only your experiences, but your insights within health and development.
Yeah, likewise, Brent. I appreciate, you know, being able to have this conversation, the opportunity to share, and to my mission is to inspire new perspective in people, because I believe that perspective shifts what leads to new action in life. So it means a lot to be able to share.
Wonderful. And I think we'll really speak about, you know, this perspective shifts that you have later within this episode. But to really start and give people a background of, you know, who you are and really your own life story, why don't you just bring us up to date about a little bit about, you know, your own health conditions of what happened and just what kind of challenges this may have had as you were working throughout your life.
Yeah, of course. So, I mean, growing up, I've always been, you know, a fairly healthy kid. The only time I was in the doctor's office or the hospital was for injuries from BMX. So that was, I guess, more self-inflicted, but not, you know, so, but yeah, other than that, you know, grew up really healthy, you know, really active, great supportive family. My mom tried to cook all, you know, healthy home-cooked meals and all that stuff. And as I was about 17, I moved out, actually left Massachusetts and moved down to North Carolina to train with Dave Mira and the other professional BMX athletes I looked up to, now become competitors with and friends and training partners. And at that time, living on my own, then I was like, oh, like, I'll just eat what I want. And, you know, I started drinking alcohol at a pretty young age and just living a poor lifestyle in terms of nutrition and, you know, my health. And I wasn't training outside of my sport. That didn't come until years later. I actually learned the hard way after blowing out my knee that we needed to train outside of just our sport. But yeah, so it was, let's see. I was about 20 to 21, and it wasn't my rookie year, but it felt like that year, 2009. I had rode X Games. I had won my first pro contest. I invented a trick and landed it in competition for the first time that won me a Harley Davidson motorcycle, and I sold it and paid my bills off for the year. So I was smart with that. Would have done things differently now with the experience and the knowledge, but I was smart with it. And, you know, I was on top of the world. And then come in 2010, I was getting ready for the season. It was March, so about a month away from that same contest I won the year prior in April. And March 2010 was trying a new trick for the first time outside of the foam pit. So, you know, getting it dialed in on the real ramp. And the first time I tried it, I, you know, over-rotated the flip and the spin of the trick out of fear of under-rotating and fell and hit my head, got a concussion. And that's what led to the first brain tumor diagnosis. And that changed my life forever, as you can imagine, but in more ways than most people don't imagine. And that's where I talked about, you know, with perspective shifts. People say like, oh, that's gonna be the worst thing that ever happened to you. And I argue that it's the best thing that ever happened to me besides being born. You know, the day I was born was what gave me life. And then that diagnosis is what changed my life and changed how I saw my life and the world. And it led me on this path of really educating myself and empowering others with the same tools and education to take, you know, our health into our own hands and create the reality that we want to live in rather than being, living in circumstance, you know? So a lot that we can dive into there, but as you mentioned, two more diagnoses, 2 and 5 years later, or 2 and 7 years later, actually leaving me with 4 brain tumors today. And along that journey, I found the ketogenic diet and lifestyle. And that's what I chose to do the third time around. No meds, no surgery, no treatment, just dove into that and applied everything I was learning, continued to learn, and reverse engineered my path in BMX with, you know, becoming friends with the people I looked up to, now doing that with the doctors, the scientists and the researchers and the other influencers and thought leaders, and just being able to help transform lives. And so to summarize all of that, you know, the best aspect that I believe that diagnosis, you know, had in my life was taking me from self to purpose. And I say that meaning I was on self, I was selfish, you know, everything I did was self-driven and it served me well. And then 1, 2, 3 wake-up calls put me on this purpose I'm living today, where I've left competition behind. I don't really ride too much anymore. I'm more focused on speaking, creating content, coaching clients, and creating resources for people to apply the same principles in their life to become, you know, as healthy and happy as they can.
Thank you for sharing that. I really appreciate it. And, you know, there's many things that we can dive into, but, you know, you're speaking about this perspective change, and it's definitely, I think the one admirable thing that you're specifically talking about is probably one of the most challenging things that you've endured and even other people endure. Usually they say that is kind of one of the most things that they are grateful for because it's brought them to a better time today. But, you know, for some people, if they don't make that shift, if they don't make that step, it's going to be looked at to themselves as such a challenging time and something that completely changed their life and made it worse. And it took away the ability for you to do something that you completely love, but it also brought you to this new avenue of life of bringing this together. And I want to know, compared to having this injury of a brain tumor, compared to any physical injury that you had, whether it was, you know, breaking any part of your body, any other aspect of just a physical injury, when it changes to being inside your mind, when it changes to the aspect of your brain, what kind of change did this have compared to just the normal physical injury that anybody would have, compared to now it's actually affecting maybe the way that you think and maybe the way that you behave and even your possibilities to go on living?
So the biggest difference between the brain tumor diagnosis and, let's say, breaking my elbow when I was younger, the biggest difference was this was something I couldn't see, and this was something that almost took my life. And those two aspects is really what shifted my perspective on health. And I don't know which one would be first, but health and consciousness, you know. So really being told you may die either way, surgery or not having the surgery, I mean, there's still a possibility. That shifted my perspective to being grateful to be alive and to have the chance to, you know, make tomorrow a reality. But then it also brought me down this route of like, man, like I never thought, you know, because like I said, the diagnosis is what got me on the route of learning about, you know, lifestyle changes and choices and, you know, specifically ketogenic lifestyle. But then as I started learning into that and metabolic therapies and metabolic damage, I was like, man, like I caused this. Because we talk about, you know, it runs in our family, it's our genetics, and it's like that's a small portion of the reality. The reality is we can influence our genes like up to 75% of them. It's called epigenetics. And so when I was like, man, like I probably caused this, fed it, and I don't want this to happen again. And it did. And then that's what got me to be more and more serious. So I think the biggest difference is an injury will heal. You can see, oh, I broke a bone or I have a cut or I have a bruise, whatever it may be. But I was like, man, like we don't think about what we do to our brain. And I believe it's because we don't see it. And the brain doesn't feel pain. You know, it perceives pain and it signals pain, but it doesn't actually feel it. And so it's like, man, we think about, oh, we got a concussion, you know, we'll just rest and heal. That does there's so many different aspects of damage that happens when you hit your head, even if it's just, you don't get knocked out, which a lot of people don't understand. Like just because you get knocked out doesn't mean you didn't get a concussion. And a brain surgery is a traumatic brain injury of its own. I didn't know that. So I think the biggest shift was just really the life-threatening aspect of it was like, man, like, you know, perspective of being grateful to be alive, but then also have a chance to improve the outcome of my tomorrow. I think those were the biggest things. And then just the perspective shift of, you know, like, rather than thinking about what if I don't wake up, let's focus on what if I do, what am I going to do differently? How's life going to be? And that's like that quote, you know, life doesn't happen to us, it happens for us, but it's a choice. So I guess the third thing that it taught me was like, we have a choice every single day, any one of us, that no one can take away. And that's our choice and perspective, how we see our life, how we see the world. And once we take accountability for that and audit our perspectives, then we can actually start making shifts to create a new reality. I actually just did an Instagram post of that, and just really getting into Dr. Joe Dispenza's work and retaining it and, you know, studying that more and more. And it just makes so much more sense now. But I learned that, you know, sent back from 2010 when I was 21. And I think that that was the biggest difference. Being told I was going to die, it forced me down these routes of optimizing my life inside and out. And now it's put me on this purpose to share with people that you can be proactive rather than reactive. I had to react to a life or death situation. And now I'm being proactive and reactive to a degree, but I'm trying to be as proactive as I can. And like I said, my mission is to inspire that perspective in people to, like, why wait till something happens like I did to optimize your life in any aspect of your life today rather than wait till tomorrow.
That's a great and valuable tip. I think it's certainly trying to find the positives at first out of what a negative situation can, but you're being proactive in terms of speaking of why health is so important and allowing people to see that these challenges can come into place, whether you think it or not, whether you're a BMX rider or not. There's many different health challenges that can come into place if you don't treat yourself accordingly. For anyone that is listening, I want to bring about, you know, some statistics to show what's going on within brain tumors and just how effective they are today in terms of providing challenges for people. And within 2019, an estimated 23,820 adults in the United States were diagnosed with a primary cancerous tumor of the brain and spinal cord. And brain tumors account for 85 to 90% of all primary CNS tumors. And speaking into the survival rate of this, the five-year survival rate for people with a cancerous brain or CNS tumor is approximately 34% for men and 36% for women. So that's 34 out of every 100 men and 36 out of every 100 women survive past the five-year survival rate of being diagnosed with a tumor. And I think that's certainly something to bring into account of your first diagnoses being about 10 years ago around this time. And I think that's showing of the strength of what you've been able to accomplish throughout many of these ways you're being able to navigate your health now. And just speaking about, you know, the strength that you have, why don't you speak about kind of whether it's the mindset or whether it's kind of what you had to do in order to put yourself in the position to gain that strength of saying, all right, I'm going to survive this. I'm going to take this next step with my life rather than just letting things unfold and saying, all right, I may survive or I may be healthy moving forward. You know, what was kind of your mindset going into that of saying, all right, I'm going to beat these statistics. I'm going to beat all of this that's facing me head on.
To be honest, I didn't look into any of that information in the beginning. I just was just focused on my life. And some things that contributed to that perspective, that mindset was, you know, my family always raised me to work hard for what you want. You can achieve anything you want. Just you got to, you know, work hard for it. That's why they allowed me to drop out of high school when I was 17 and pursue BMX and eventually finished high school 4 years later. And now I've become really passionate about education, where I want to be educated on. So that, and then my mom's story of battling colon cancer and alive and well today, you know, those in combination with any athlete understands this, like failure is only, it's like, I don't know how I would word it, but like failure isn't what people see it as. Athletes use failure as just an opportunity to learn. That's why they become athletes of any, you know, amateur or professional, especially professional athletes. Like you accept to quote unquote fail means you're going to fall down, but you're going to get up and try again. And so BMX, you know, I grew up playing baseball and basketball, but BMX, there was a lot more pain involved with those falls. You didn't just miss a shot or not make the team. You fell to the flat concrete or the cement or the dirt or the wood, whatever it was, it hurts. And the ability to choose to get up and try that trick again, knowing that that's a possibility, but you ignored the fear, that contributed to my mom's story and, you know, what was instilled in me at a young age to work hard. And I think that's what did it for me. It was like, I just treated the brain tumor diagnosis like any other injury. And like I said earlier, rather than focusing on what if I don't wake up, what if I do, was, you know, and so I started focusing on like, all right, what do we do, doctor? You know, like, you're the doctor, you're the, you know, you're the surgeon. Like, what, how's this work? What do we do? And there was a moment, there was about a week and a half, 2 weeks from diagnosis to surgery. It happened really quick. And actually Dr. Friedman here at Duke University moved his patient schedule around to get me in sooner because it was that severe. But there was a moment where obviously the first, we didn't talk about this, but when I got diagnosed, I was by myself. I thought I was going in and going to be told 2 weeks off the bike from the MRI I had a day or two prior. I didn't know, like they didn't know. Like I got accidentally diagnosed with a brain tumor and I was by myself, just turned 21 a few months prior. And so when I was, you know, told this information, I instantly went into shock. And the first thing that came to mind was like, I'm dead. Doesn't matter if it's cancerous or benign. I didn't know. I didn't know the difference. I just, I mean, you're 21 years old, you think you're invincible, and then you get diagnosed with a brain tumor, the first thing that comes to mind is death. And I started freaking out. You know, the victim card was huge. I was just like, you know, why is this happening to me? Like really asking if I was a bad person that such a thing would be happening. And like, I was living my dream and now it's about to be taken away on top of, you know, a death sentence. And I think, you know, my mom, my family raising me, and then just being that level of an athlete and accepting pain and failure for what they are, what I choose to make them, allowed me to look at this as another injury and just, what do I got to do to get over it? Rather than focusing on, you know, the reality of the negatives, what about the possibilities that can come from this? And now, you know, it's been this April 2020 will be 10 years since my surgery, April 16th. And there's just been a lot of time to reflect and learn and grow. And now it just makes so much sense. Like this was, I was able to overcome it and I was able to use it. And that's why I'm so passionate about what I'm doing today and no longer passionate about riding my bike. It's because I believe that there's a higher purpose for me to have gone through that than just to ride my bike and call it a day and go get a job. Back to your original question. Yeah, I definitely believe the mindset was influenced from my family and just being that level of an athlete and what you had to endure to foster that reality I was living in, and then using that to treat it like an injury rather than, you know, some death sentence, which I did. But during that period, it shifted. And it just, I don't remember exactly when, but it started shifting into like, all right, it's just an injury. You know, like, when can I ride? That was the question. Like, when can I ride? What can I do? And that led me down this route of challenging different hardships in my life, whether it be business or relationships, and really just what can I do to optimize my situation that's going to bring me closer to the desired future. And then, you know, about 3 years ago, Dr. Joe's work came in there and just really taught me the power of our mind, what it does chemically. And then rather than waiting for a cause to create an effect, let's affect a cause in our life. And that's what I was doing back then. Didn't know it, but I was really focusing on that. So definitely the mindset was, you know, huge in that. And it was a choice, which it's hard. I've been in some painful, like that. And it's funny because the brain tumor diagnosis, the surgery and all that, that was literally, there's no pain in any of it. I was in so much pain after surgery, even after the meds from surgery wore off, I was pain-free. But when I broke a rib 2 years ago, I was tortured for like a week. Like, and so it's just, yeah, it's interesting to reflect on those things. And it's the choice in our mindset to move forward in any aspect of life. So that's what I believe.
It certainly shows you the power of the mind and how we can navigate through many of these challenges. And, you know, you're speaking a lot about having this awareness, having this consciousness of, you know, what you have the power to do and what you have the power to create within your mind and body in terms of health, in terms of just the awareness of how you should go about your day. And, you know, speaking on this topic, what brought you to become really self-aware and change this perspective in life? You spoke a little bit about how your family and, you know, just the impact that this had within yourself, but within creating the self-awareness, what were some of, you know, different types of exercises or activities that you're using to learn to train your brain, to learn to, you know, bring yourself to the position to know about, all right, this is what I should eat during the day, this is how I should exercise? You know, how did you strategically place, you know, these avenues around your life? Because you certainly weren't just, you know, given the aspect of, all right, these are steps to make yourself healthy, this is what I'll do. You know, what kind of surroundings do you put into place? How do you change your environment in order to bring yourself to become self-aware and become healthy within your own life?
So I was just in a state of pain and suffering, and I was getting tired of that. And I was getting tired of living paycheck to paycheck, tired of toxic relationships, whether it be, you know, intimate relationship or just friends, or I was just in a place where I was fed up and I didn't have any formal systems. I just was like, okay, you know, I'm unhappy. Okay, what can I do about that? And just by, like, you know, Joe Rogan's podcast actually helped me a lot in the early years of just like accountability. Like, you are where you are because you're choosing to do so. And before that, it started with nutrition, because that was the first piece. It was just like, oh, food isn't just fuel. And like, we know X, Y, and Z are bad, but to what degree? I don't think people would make the choices. I think more times than not, majority of people wouldn't make certain choices if they knew that that bad food did more than what they actually thought. So that's where it started, was nutrition. And then after that, blew out my knee 3 years after the brain surgery, and, you know, learns about fitness and exercise and what that does for the brain. So all my focus was just like, really, like, out of, you know, fear for my brain health, like, how can I optimize that? And then, you know, it was 2016. A friend showed me some work from Dr. Joe. I think it might have been his TED Talk that I got introduced to first, but just really understanding, like, your personality creates your personal reality. And the first step is accountability for your life and not making excuses, but then self-awareness and, you know, consciousness after that. And then the formal things started coming, you know. So it started with nutrition, you know, the second diagnosis of kind of the first diagnosis after recovery, but then really hit home the second diagnosis, and then really got into gear specifically the third. But it started with that, and then really, like, okay, well, I can go through a health coaching certification to learn more and learn how to help people. I can read books, you know, learning all these different systems and, like, you know, practices, you know, just basic stuff like don't eat this, eat that, you know, here's how you can optimize. And then fitness, you know, getting into an exercise routine. And then the mindset was the last piece of my awareness. Had I just didn't know that the whole time I was practicing these different principles of discipline. And, you know, I think law of association started to take over, and it just became like that's how I am now. Like, I've always been stubborn and ADHD and all that stuff, and now I'm learning how that's helped me and how I can harness it to help myself moving forward. So it really just started from a place of pain and suffering and wanting to better my life in different areas. And as I dove into those areas to educate myself, the formal systems came in, you know, and these different practices that I implement today. But it just started with wanting more for my life, because I feel like, and doing something about it. It's one thing to want to better your reality. It's another thing to believe that you can influence your reality and that you're going to do something about it. And so it's funny, because this question, actually, when I get done with my presentations, I usually end it with four questions. It's, what do you want in your life? What do you need in your life? What's holding you back? And what are you willing to do for those things you want and need? And it's simple. It's not easy, but it's super simple. And that's why I share, because I want people to learn through the lens of my life that you can go the harder route. You can, you know, oh, you know, I'm fine now. And, you know, you can wait till something happens, or you can optimize now. It just starts with a belief that you can control the outcome of your life. So I know that was a lot here and there, but I think the ultimate piece to that was just wanting to better myself in certain areas, and then diving in and then learning how to apply it in specific ways that work for me. Because not everyone's morning routine is going to be the same thing that's effective for you, and it may cause you more stress. So really just, I guess, just creating that awareness and accountability for my life and just wanting to better it.
It's incredible, and it's a true testament of, you know, this aspect that you need to help yourself before you can go out and have this impact on other people. And, you know, it's shown that you endured such a challenge and were able to find that you need to look within yourself to make these improvements. And it wasn't just something that you can, you know, go through this injury and then go back to your everyday of what you were beforehand. And you took these steps of, you know, providing the right environment around yourself, providing this association of people and education around you to make those steps. Then you learned the power of telling your story and how that can impact people, whether it's somebody who's going through similar experiences or whether it's somebody who, like you're saying, needs to be proactive and needs to take that step before something could happen, before they need to endure a challenging experience. I do think struggle is inevitable. It's something that's needed, but like you're saying, if you're able to be proactive and take that initial step, it helps anybody down the long run. And as you were working through this, when did you really see the impact of sharing your story? What kind of drove you to say, I was able to help myself, maybe this can be impactful towards anybody, even if they're not a BMX rider, even if, you know, they haven't endured a brain tumor? How can people hear my story and be able to make that next step within their life, whether it's within the health realm or whether it's even just within self-awareness and that lifestyle change?
Yeah, before I answer that, to the point you just made, you know, with stress comes growth. I mean, that's what we see as human beings. When you're acutely stressed, you adapt, you become stronger, whether it's metabolically, whether it's physical, or it's the mind. Like, that's just how the body works. When you're chronically stressed, you know, you're like, that's when problems happen because your body can't adapt. And there's that saying, like, pain is inevitable, suffering is a choice. And like I said, I was in a lot of pain, and no one, I don't think, would have doubted me or judged me except for my immediate, you know, friends and family, because they knew better. But if I just, yeah, I'm done riding, you know, poor me, you know, I'm just going to live this, you know, small life, you know, but that's not me. And that's not who raised me. So I think suffering is a choice. And we see that every day, like, people are complaining and they're not doing that. You know, we're quick to talk and slow to act. And so, like, I just chose, like, man, I've had enough. And I don't want people to get to that point, because that point sometimes is too far that we can't, you know, we can't make a lot of changes that's going to affect our reality. So, but to your question, I was actually forced to share my story. I didn't want to, because I felt embarrassed. I felt broken. I felt like I'm like this weak person, because I got diagnosed with a brain tumor, and what are people going to think of me and the judgment and all this and that. But I did an interview with a BMX media company, just sharing, you know, before and after the surgery. We did a video and stuff too. And just the feedback I got from people just sharing, you know, to me, it's still, I'm aware of it now, but it's still a challenge for me to accept the reality of what I've gone through being so significant to the average person, the just hears my story, talks to me, because to me, I lived it. It wasn't, and back to, you know, earlier we were talking about the diagnosis, it was just something I had to do. And there's no longer a choice for me to give in to fear and to play small. It's like, this is just something I need to go through. And so every step of the way, whether it's an injury, it's a diagnosis, it's, you know, someone in my life passing, whatever it is, it's just been what I've lived. And the vision I have based on that purpose is strong enough that it just keeps me going forward. And just, how can I use this? How can I, you know, whether, you know, my younger brother passed away the other year. It's like, how can I bring his name along and help more people and relate to more people? And so by sharing the first time, I saw some feedback of like, man, like you said earlier, like, it may not have been even a BMX athlete, but someone that was going through a challenging time in their life. I don't like to judge people's stories, but a lot of people say, well, man, I haven't gone through what you've gone through. And I'm like, well, I don't have your life. You don't have mine, you know, but they'll say that. And they're like, man, seeing what you went through inspired me to get over whatever this is, or to push past it, or to, you know, optimize how I can, you know, live a better life. And as I started to notice that, I got to the point with the third diagnosis in 2017, there was no sadness. There was no anger. There was no victim mentality or frustration. It literally, the first thing that popped into my mind was, all right, well, how can I use this? Like, how can I use this to help myself, but also help other people? And that's when I decided to leave competition that year, before the season even started, to really get focused on what I'm doing today. And had our sport had a larger platform like any other mainstream sport, it would have made sense to stay there and continue, you know, what I'm doing. But the reality is BMX is still very small. You know, people don't really understand it. They don't see it. And there's not, you know, there's not a big media presence. So I was like, all right, well, I mean, I never thought I'd be speaking, but now I'm getting asked to speak at, you know, conferences and events, and I'm creating content and storytelling and, you know, all these things. And I think I forget your original question now, because I kind of went on a rant, but I think the storytelling, no, that's what it was. The storytelling started out of like, I guess I'll do it, to now it's like, I'm passionate about doing it because I've seen the impact it has on other people. And then them being able to share their story. That's something I didn't think about happening, is I've encouraged other people, whether it be a similar story that I've gone through with health or injury, or, you know, sharing stories about my brother and Dave Mirra with suicide, and how, like, a lot of people have a similar experience, but they're, reluctant to share it because they're afraid of being judged or their family judging them. And I've recently helped a woman, I was like, hey, you share if you want, but like, don't put the action of going through sharing or not based on other people's judgment, because I'm here to share with you that, you're going to do a huge amount of justice for other people, allowing them to feel free and, how they can relate. And she was like so thankful because she shared and she got amazing support from her family and her friends. And so the power of sharing, I think it just brings people together. Because there's so many times where, you probably experience this, but you just feel so alone sometimes. And, whether it's a hardship or this or that, it's like, man, like, what are people going to think about this? But the more you share, the more you see we're all related one way or another. It doesn't matter if you're making, 8-10 figures a year, or if you're not making any money a year, it doesn't matter. Like, you're still like, everyone's human.
It's beautifully said, Josh. I appreciate you stating that, because it really is the power of storytelling has such a vast impact. And you can see now today why everybody's out there trying to share their message in order to help people see that we're all going through something. Whether we have the same stories, whether we experience the same things, we all have these emotions, we all have these experiences. And in order to share that with other people, it allows us to move forward, to find other aspects of how we can improve our health, how we can improve the way we see ourselves. And there's so many different avenues of just personal development. And you can see that within all this storytelling. It really just allows you to see, all right, maybe I can do this one thing different, or, change my habits, change my morning routine a little bit there. Here's where I can improve. And that's certainly the beauty of storytelling. I think what we've spoken about so far has been, such a testament to what you've been able to experience and what you've been able to learn so far. And I think this is a good time to then switch into our next part within speaking about the ketogenic diet and speaking about how you've been able to use health to treat your mind and body right. So for now, I'd just like to thank everybody for taking this time to listen to part one of this episode and hearing about what Josh Perry had to speak about, what he had to experience within his own life to create this mindset, create this awareness to make himself better. And within part two of this episode, we're going to be speaking more about the ketogenic diet and what goes into play within this diet and maybe how you can implement this within your own life. So thank you all again for listening to episode number 11 of season 2 of the Mental Insights podcast. And please be sure to tune in to the next episode to hear more.
Thank you all for listening to today's episode of the Mental Insights podcast. Make sure to reach out to today's guest or myself if you need any advice, guidance, or support in your life today. Please be sure to like, subscribe, and review to this podcast so we know what you thought of this episode. I look forward to being in touch with you all in the next episode. I hope you all have a wonderful day.